You're listening to the audio production of Fields of Grace, Sharing Faith from the Horse Farm by Cara Whitney, with Michael Ross, published by Thomas Nelson and read by Erin Bennett. Foreword by Dan Whitney, Larry the Cable Guy. I am so proud of my wife and the journey that has led her to this fantastic relationship she has with Jesus. I mean, it's incredible. In the Bible, whenever Jesus was doing miracles, they always said the people marveled at what he had just done. That's exactly how I feel about my wife, Cara, every time she starts writing these books. I marvel. It's not the same marvel as she does with me when I don't take out the trash, or the kind of marveling she extends my way when I don't clean up my side of the closet. Those marvels have negative connotations. But the marvel I'm talking about is a giddy happiness of unbelief of how God can work in a person's life when they give everything to him. My faith itself has been strengthened by my wife's relationship with our awesome Savior. And that's exactly what it is if you're doing it right. A personal relationship with Jesus. He's our friend. It's so crazy to me how God works. I grew up in the church, Wednesday night prayer meeting, Sunday morning, Sunday evening, youth group, potluck dinners in the basement of the church. Many years of prayer, coleslaw, and hamburger hot dishes. Then I got in the entertainment business and fell faster than a fat guy getting off the couch with numb legs. I can say that because I'm a fat guy, and when I sit on the couch, my legs go numb, and then I... Ugh, never mind. I digress. I tell this little story because it's an amazing look into how God works and how important evangelism is. I marveled at the fact that Jesus worked through my wife, which in turn made me, a backslid Christian, rededicate myself to the most important thing in this world, a personal relationship with Jesus. Now, this is my wife's book, so I don't want to get too long-winded in this foreword, but since I'm on the couch with numb legs from sitting with this computer, I'm obviously not moving for a while, so let me just say a few more things. We live in a godless time. A time where Christian people need to step up and be bold about our faith. Not in a, hey buddy, you better yada 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 Bible thumping kind of way, but in a loving, hey, you're my friend, and I want you to know the hope and happiness I found in Jesus, because I want you with me in heaven, kind of way. If you want to be a real rebel in this world, stand up for Christ. That's being a world changer. I know it's scary sometimes to share your faith, and we all want to be liked. But if you really care for people, the most loving thing you can do for that person is to introduce them to the truth and hope that is Jesus Christ. It's true freedom. Never, ever be ashamed to speak out about Jesus, because you never know whose life God can change in a quick conversation. It's about planting a seed and letting God do the rest. People are hurting in this world, and you may think they don't want to hear you ramble about Jesus over an Arby's beef and cheddar, but just when you think it was all for naught, guess what? You'll more than likely be the one they come calling on when their life falls apart. Trust me, it happens all the time to me. You don't have to be a world-popular, renowned preacher or a missionary to the Zulu nation to change a life. You know what you need? You just need to be unashamed and bold enough to drop a little nugget of truth into someone's head. God has used, in worldly terms, some of the most timid, uninfluential people ever to turn others into world changers. The only way they were able to be a world changer is because you changed their world. You gotta remember something. No matter where you work, or what you do, or what your lot in life is, we are all part of this awesome body of Christ. You may be just a pinky toe, but you're just as needed as the head, the eyes, and the ears. Everybody plays a part. That's how it works. Never think you're not in a position to share your hope. People need it and want it. They may not act like it, but now, especially in these times, they are looking for happiness, and that's a fact. You can not only give them happiness, but you can also give them hope, which will last forever. Can I get an amen? This book my wife, Cara, wrote is just exactly about this, sharing the hope we all have in Jesus and standing up for what's true and right and giving people freedom in the true love of Christ. Be bold, be a rebel, and share what you have with others and watch the people marvel. God is good. Ugh, my legs. Introduction. Sharing starts with caring. All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I am with you always, to the very end of the age. Matthew chapter 28, verses 18 to 20. Matthew 28 shares such encouraging words from Jesus. Yet for some of us, these verses trigger more guilt than comfort. We think, how can I go and make disciples of all nations when reality forces me to stay where I am? We have families to take care of, demanding jobs, busy schedules, and a big stack of bills to pay each month. The reasons not to go all sound good on paper. But honestly, was Jesus really talking to everyday, ordinary people? I wondered these things too. I mean, I'm a farm girl, so I'm used to multitasking. But this can feel a bit overwhelming. And before I committed my life to Christ, I thought that churches were filled with hypocrites and that most believers were, well, just plain crazy. To me, they were all ranting street corner evangelists who waved turn or burn tracts in people's faces and then exclaimed, Jesus loves you. Say what? They'd pound the pulpit, shake the Bible like a weapon over people's heads, and speak a language I didn't understand. The Lord separates the sheep from the goats. Repent. We're sinners who have been saved by the blood of the Lamb. I couldn't help noticing that Christians manufactured their own lines of jewelry with crosses and purity rings, and they had their own tattoos. They posted bumper stickers on their cars claiming, I'm not perfect, just forgiven, right next to a silver fish symbol. There were Christians-only housing communities. Christian business owners gave discounts to those who would say, I'm a Christian, or I work at fill-in-the-blank ministry. They had their own buzzwords, such as cell groups, megachurches, born again, and on fire. The churches some attended determined their status. Many even dressed alike. Honestly, I was confused. And maybe I'm stubborn or just a slow study, but it took years of asking questions, observing Christ followers, and seeking the one true God of the Bible before I could commit my life to Him. So what finally clicked for me? I eventually met Christ followers who were 100% genuine. These particular folks weren't into gimmicks and sales pitches, and they didn't hide in a subculture. They truly loved God and were committed to sharing that love with everyone they met. True, some of them were weird, and none of them were perfect, yet they were authentic. They helped me realize that God forgives me and loves me exactly the way I am. I didn't have to perform or try to be someone different. I discovered that Jesus wants me to be me. Eventually, I clued into a secret that would guide my relationship with God for the rest of my life. I needed to fall in love with Jesus. I needed to pursue Christ as my closest companion and best friend in life. It was important to put all else aside to be with Him, and it's the same today. He must be the priority of my heart, even while I attend to the everyday business of life. Being in relationship with Him isn't about religion or following the rules. To be in true relationship with Jesus means pursuing His heart, His passions, His character, His truth. What's more, I must be his hands, his feet, and a reflection of his love to others. Nurturing a relationship with someone involves trust, transparency, surrender, and above all, a two-way connection. Close friends, especially lovers, must talk and grow together daily, not just occasionally. Makes sense, right? It's the same with God. Our eyes can't be fixed on churchianity, looking Christian, saying Christian things to impress Christian family and friends, all the while thinking it also impresses God. If we let him, Jesus will begin a painful work in us. It won't happen overnight, and it will come with a mix of joy, tears, and the heart-pounding expectation that our lives are taking a radical new turn. He'll slowly strip away the masks, the false assumptions, the bad theology, the idols, and the chilly layers between him and us, and little by little our hearts will warm up to him. And somewhere along the way, we'll discover that we just can't keep quiet about this amazing thing that has happened to us. The love we share with our Savior will overflow and touch others. Christ's love is much too great to be contained in a single human heart. It must be lived out and multiplied. May the Lord make your love increase and overflow for each other and for everyone else, just as ours does for you. 1 Thessalonians chapter 3, verse 12. It's this kind of relationship that has compelled me to go. Behind every human life is a story, and behind every story is the author, the builder of history, the maker of the ages, our loving creator who reveals himself through a book. The Bible is his message of salvation, the ultimate story of restoration, of hope, of eternal life through Jesus Christ. And God is calling us to take his story to heart, living it, working it out in our daily lives, and sharing it with everyone we meet. Once I made the decision to receive Christ, I knew I was saved, but I have to admit that in the days after my conversion, I didn't feel any different than before. I found myself asking, "Okay, God, now what?" I desperately wanted to feel something deeper with Jesus, but how would I go about grabbing intangible faith and making it my own? I spent hours feeding a need for biblical knowledge, cramming in as much information about the whys as I could. I did Bible study after Bible study, 7 days a week, memorizing scripture. Also, during this time, my body started breaking down. I had lost 15 pounds of weight, and I had no idea why. As I stood in my kitchen, receiving a phone call from my doctor saying that I needed to have more tests, I glanced up at a chalkboard where I had written 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 7. "Cast all your anxiety on him because he cares for you." Up until that moment, it was just another verse that I was trying to memorize. But as I stood there in that swaying room, feeling like I just had half the breath kicked out of my chest, I suddenly became spiritually alive. I had the realization that despite believing in Jesus, I had not gone all in yet. I had not cast everything on God. I had given him my mind, but not anything else, and I was still holding on to things I thought I could control. No matter what my health diagnosis was, what really mattered was how I glorified God through whatever purposeful journey he placed me on. It was a moment that lasted only a matter of seconds, but I can tell you that nothing but God mattered in that kitchen. Not my husband, not my kids. Just him. It was the moment in which my life became God's completely, and I became saved with the purpose of furthering the gospel, not as a reward for all the studying I had been doing, but because I was willing to give him the most protected part of me. I gave him my heart, and he gave me a heart for the lost. At this very moment, there are 151,600 people in this world preparing for a tomorrow that will never come. That makes me want to roll up my sleeves, because I wonder how many of them have been told about Jesus? How many of them are spiritually dead? Each of them will exist eternally, but where will they spend it? In heaven with God, or forever separated from him? It hinges on how they responded to Jesus and his gift of salvation. Yet I can't help but wonder, have they been told? Christianity is not a rest stop on the way to heaven. If you truly believe Jesus is Savior of the world, and you believe that he will come back again for the church, then this world should not be able to keep you quiet. Jesus told us there is joy in heaven for every sinner who comes to repentance. Let's give heaven 151,600 more reasons to rejoice today. Chapter 1. Evangelism, a dirty word? Christ's love compels us because we are convinced that one died for all, and therefore all died. And he died for all, that those who live should no longer live for themselves, but for him who died for them and was raised again. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verses 14 to 15. When I was a farm kid in Wisconsin, I owned some beautiful horses. But the first one I purchased as an adult is a horse I still own today, and one I absolutely adore. His name is Orlando, and he is the cover model of my first book, Unbridled Faith. He's a stunner with his beautiful chestnut coloring and gorgeous blonde locks. Orlando is truly the Ken doll of horses, and he has an adorable personality to boot, drawing people in with authentic affection. Because he's so gentle with strangers, Orlando now serves an important role as a therapy horse. For several days now, he's been out at a ranch in Hickman, Nebraska, a stone's throw from our farm near Lincoln. Orlando is helping a young girl internally process the loss of her grandmother. He has become a patient friend to this grieving child, letting the girl brush him and lean into him. I'm so thankful that my favorite horse is being used for such a noble purpose. But I'll be honest, I sometimes catch myself wondering how that's even possible. This beautiful creature also has a dark side. Orlando is extremely jealous of other horses, which makes him very aggressive toward them. While I'm no horse behaviorist, I think part of the problem is that he was raised to be a dressage horse. In other words, he lived in a stall his entire life and was trained to run patterns in an arena. He was never let out into a pasture to learn the etiquette of living in a community. In a sense, he's been institutionalized his whole life, so he views other horses as competition. I've tried on several occasions to nudge Orlando over this hump, and a couple of years ago, I thought I'd found the answer. I decided to pair him up with some of my more passive horses, a herd of my four-legged friends that were, as horse folk would say, low in the pecking order. I was sure Orlando would automatically be crowned king, and with that, he would enjoy a life of grazing peacefully with other horses. I gave Orlando a few months to commune over the fence with the herd. When his interactions with them seemed healthy, I decided it was time to open the gate that had separated them. Big mistake. Before I could stop him, Orlando launched an all-out barnyard brawl. Almost immediately, he started chasing my youngest Norwegian fjord horse, Oaken, biting at him and trying to push him down. I sprang into action, yelling and waving my hands, desperately trying to get Oaken to run behind the gate I was holding open. I needed to separate the two 1,200-pound animals, but how? Doing so would risk getting me and Oaken killed. As my adrenaline surged, my moment of helplessness turned into instinct. I hopped on a four-wheeler, which was attached to a manure spreader, and I told my high school-aged helper, Lindsay, to open the main pasture gate and seek a safe place out of the way. My plan? Try to place the poop rig between Orlando and Oaken, who by this time was about to collapse with exhaustion. If that happened, Orlando would stomp the life out of the...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.